taking children into care proceedings, where there's a lot of work that's involved in preparing your case files. There'll be a particular waiting for children who are newly subject to a child protection plan. There's a lot of work to mitigate and manage the risks. There'll be a smaller percentage of waiting because the child will need a case. So that caseload waiting system is working well. In terms of counting numbers, our average case load is between 20 and 25. We review very early in the day. And if anybody's case load gets up to 30, that's when we start to see more of those. And on average, on a monthly basis, there'll be about three social workers contributing to 30-31 cases. So we keep going for a whole panel on this. Social workers who are newly qualified are in their assessed and supported year of employment for the first year, and they should have a case load of no more between 12 and 15. And we're pretty near that for most of our newly qualified social workers. And then that page just says how we pull in some temporary social workers if we've got vacancies. We do have a number of vacancies. We have too many agents of social workers, in my view, and that brings instability in terms of churn, change in relationships to children. But we are now recruiting on a monthly basis and interviewing on a monthly basis, and there's a dedicated chance for to be the in terms of social work support for computers, the WICO STEM equipment replacement project started being rolled out in autumn 2014. The social workers are now able to upgrade the laptops. Recommendation 19 is a review of things, which you've moved down. Just a quick comment, you have not received a lot of the internal audit that's been commissioned in relation to the comments on recommendation 19. review of so-called pay progression intentions currently underway. I wondered when it would be complete and how, you know, you would, if this just being there, when you would this just then being able to look at it again. Okay. It's about 18 months since we implemented the pay grading auditions. And what we have found is that whereas our social workers are paid on a par really with places like Sefton and Bury and Oldham, our two adjacent immediate neighbours pay a lot more. So that's Liverpool and Cheshire, Western Chester. So we're reviewing it at the moment. I'm not 100% clear time scale for the review to be completed, but we do need clear data on that so that we can implement any changes. So I'll let you know.
Anybody else? Yes,
Mark. Lots of these recommendations are issues that have been put ongoing and ongoing for many, many years. I was a social worker in Wirral myself a long time ago. And a lot of these things like involving partners in social work assessments, formal notifications of family members, contact with individual family members, etc., etc. It's more about good practice, isn't it, than what's going on, because we can say, oh, that's what we should do. The question is about quality assurance, really. How does that happen? So, for example, if the case is closing, who has the ultimate check on that all these things have been covered before the case has been closed? So, in other words, a social worker hasn't reflected the voice of, say, somebody from the health service who's saying, no, go back and check with them before you close the case.
It's a team manager's responsibility for assessing all the tasks that have been undertaken before cases are closed. What we have experienced over a period of time, certainly before we implemented the reorganisation, and to some degree in some areas since, there has been some turnover with team managers and some vacancies. And so our big issue is making sure that there's absolute consistency across the board in terms of making sure that best practice is applied at all times. And that is a constant challenge to make sure that's the case. And that is something that the current inspection will be looking at too.
So that sign off, when they sign off, should cover all of these points?
It should. And I think one of the issues that managers have to look at as well is, I say often, making judgments within bounds of tolerance. If a child traditionally has a fractured skull, for example, that's very clearly a very urgent and serious child protection concern. And people swing straight into action. It's the blue light equivalent of social work. And everything usually runs properly. Where there are situations where there's cumulative concerns about neglect and things get a bit better and they get a bit worse, and people can sometimes be focusing on parents who seem to be really striving and trying, and the eye can be drawn with the partnership away from the child. It's those kinds of situations that you sometimes look back with hindsight and say, we could have and should have got a grip much sooner. And it's how we get a cohort of managers who are generally really good people, desperate trying to get it right for children, working in a framework where they're encouraged to question and challenge and be supported to make good judgments about human conditions, where there's often not an absolute right or an absolute wrong, but where people can use all the best evidence for judgments that stand up to scrutiny. So it's not a simple science anymore.
communicate it's okay doing this, that, and the other, but if there's no evidence that it's actually closing that attainment gap, it's not doing what it's supposed to do.
Children with a degree of, or their families experience financial hardship, draw down the group premium. So there's a considerable amount of money per child going into school. So there's been a scheme whereby on giving these youngsters